As it's Valentine's Day, I thought I'd write you an appropriate short story. So the next time you're having a coffee, sit back for 10 or so minutes and enjoy. This is called LoveCat. It was a tiger. Not the kind you'd expect to find on an Indian mountainside, obviously. But then Cowley on a rainy February morning was about as far away from exotic as you could get. This one was a huge, once plush, cuddly toy, an effigy of a snow tiger. It was discarded. Its 5-foot body was draped over a green telephone exchange cabinet, just past the railway bridge, the tail extending down into an oily puddle. A patch of black grime had been smeared along one side of its belly between its front and back legs. On its left shoulder, a hole was ripped and rain-soaked stuffing was spilling out onto the grey ground below. Once Becky had realised what she was looking at, she was sure the tiger had been there for some time. She'd have sensed that she'd seen it yesterday morning, which had been Monday, but grime had already painted it into the background of the landscape. She hadn't taken notice then. She'd had another morning fight with Daryl, and she'd been reliving that on her way to work, clutching the steering wheel, imagining all the retorts she could have used if she'd not been so flustered and upset. Besides, yesterday the Garsington Road hadn't been so backed up. There'd been no queue of traffic to sit and stare out of the windows, wishing she was somewhere, anywhere else, instead of the long line that led to drudgery. The cars inched forward. Someone revved, impatient, then a horn beeped admonishment. The rain slapped the windscreen. Becky looked over her shoulder to get a final look at the tiger. A steady stream of rainwater flowed off one sodden ear and splashed onto the pavement. There was another beep. She whipped her head around. The car in front had managed to move a whole 8 feet.
All right, all right.
Becky waved apology in the rear window and pressed the accelerator.
It's not like any of us are going anywhere.
As the young woman in the red Astra passed by, a light so dim that you wouldn't see it unless you leaned in close sparked behind the tiger's gaze. It looked out into the road through green glass eyes that had, a moment before, been sightless and dead. Deep inside, something small and warm and very, very old stretched and felt its way around its new body. It felt the cold water running through its fur, soaking into its foam stuffing, making it fat with moisture. The woman in the Astra slowly disappeared up the road, replaced by other equally bored drivers. Some glanced over, blank expressions changing for just a moment before returning to their own contemplations. The rain continued, relentless. The tiger didn't mind, though. It knew it was exactly where it should be. It knew exactly where it needed to go. Becky thought about the tiger toy on and off throughout the day. She thought about it through relentless, boring morning meetings about auto parts sales targets. She thought about it over lunch in the crowded refectory where she sat alone, listening to the laughter of her call centre colleagues. And what finally dawned on her, back in her cubicle in the afternoon, was that she felt guilty. It was ridiculous, of course. It was just a collection of man-made fibres, probably sewn together in a Chinese factory, crammed with cheap stuffing and shipped to the West for a quick Christmas sale. It couldn't feel the rain. It didn't know it had been thrown away by some idiot too ignorant to take it to a designated waste dump. It would eventually get moved by a street cleaner, and the road would be tidy again. Her heart skipped a beat at that thought. The tiger, consigned to the jaws of a refuse van, or a black hole in a tip next to old cans and bags of dog poo. The hairs on the back of her arms came up in fear. After a moment, she shook the thoughts from her head and laughed to herself. So stupid. Maeve, who sat closest to her and seemed nice enough, looked up, furrowing her brows quizzically. What?
Nothing.
Becky smiled quickly and bent to her desk. She stared at the list of garages she still had to call that afternoon, then picked up her headset again. By the time Becky climbed back into her car that evening, a plan was forming in her subconscious. Little images of her picking up the tiger kept flashing into her head. The feel of its cold, wet fur in her hand. The damp smell that would permeate the car as the windows misted up. Finally, as she pulled back onto the Garsington Road, She steeled herself and said, "If he's still there, I'll stop and pick him up." As she said it, a shiver of anticipation ran through her. It had become he. She was involved now. Unconsciously, her foot pressed a little harder on the pedal. The road bent round to the left. There he was, stood on the green cabinet. The ceaseless rain had taken its toll. His weight sagged with the weight of water. His eyes looked down at the road, almost despondent. Becky felt a wave of sympathy at how badly the day had treated him. Of course, there was another queue. Everyone was battling to get onto the Oxford Ring Road and home. She slowed down to a crawl, and then a stop. And that's when the voices of doubt began to whisper. It was still ridiculous. What was she thinking? Dragging an old stuffed toy out of the rain? To do what? How could she possibly repair it? Look at that side. If she wasn't mistaken, that was oil smeared along it. That wouldn't come off with just soap and water. And how the hell would she dry it out? She'd be laughed at for trying, and she hated, hated, hated being laughed at. She was next to it now. The doubt had cast the tiger and it again. She glanced across. No, stupid idea. Just go home and stop being such a fluffy idiot, she thought to herself. She forced her head to face forwards and gritted her teeth all the way to the roundabout. Yet, instead of going straight across the roundabout towards the city centre and home, she found herself indicating right. She missed her turning, went under the flyover and back onto the Garsington Road. Oh, bloody hell, Becky muttered to herself. She really was doing it. She passed the green exchange cabinet without glancing over, almost as if looking again would signal her intention to other drivers, as if they'd care. 100 metres further on, she turned into the car park of the Oxford Bus Company. Most of the spaces were empty, their staff having already gone home without getting involved in any cuddly toy-based lunacy. She took a deep breath, nerves making her chest tingle, and clambered out of the car. She pulled her raincoat up, glad of the excuse to hide her face, and hurried from the car park. A sick feeling rose in her throat. The queue was still solid. Her act of salvage was going to be embarrassingly public. Her feet splashed through dirty puddles. She didn't dare look up. She was in the wrong footwear for this. In fact, apart from her coat, she was in the wrong clothes entirely. What must the drivers be thinking, seeing her tottering through the downpour in a pair of French heels and grey tights? Silly cow, probably. And then, she was there, standing in front of a crappy, wet toy tiger that lolled to the ground. Go on, she willed herself. She could hardly stand here, heart pumping like she'd just finished a sprint, staring at him. That would be even more moronic. Go on! Her arm jerked out and grabbed the scruff of his neck, just above where the stuffing was falling out. She spun around, clutching his huge body to her slight one, and marched double time back towards the car. She tried to keep her eyes to the ground, tried not to glance into the cars, but a self-destructive curiosity compelled her eyes up. Sure enough, the drivers in the three nearest ones were staring at her, a similar look of surprise on their faces. In the second, a female passenger was quite clearly saying "Jippo" to her companion. Becky forced her eyes down again, feeling the heat of shame. If she didn't get to the car quickly, there was a good chance they'd see her throw up too. After what seemed like minutes, though it couldn't have been more than one, she reached the safety of her car. She hadn't even locked it. She wrenched open the door, stuffed the tiger over into the passenger seat, and threw herself in. She waited. Her heart gradually slowed. In the road, the line of cars died down. When she was happy that no one who had seen her could possibly be still out there, she drove out and joined the traffic. Her nausea was all but gone. She took another deep breath, this time in relief. Then she glanced across at the tiger. Well, Becky smiled. That wasn't what I thought the day would hold, tiger. Then she added, I'm Becky, by the way, as if it was the most natural thing in the world. The tiger listened as Becky chattered away to him. He didn't move, or make a sound, or give any indication that he was more than a toy that had seen better days. And so, soon she began to give away her innermost thoughts. People had always talked to him and his kind. They'd begged for his blessings when they'd cowered in caves by fires. Later, in towns and villages, they'd offered a place at their hearths and in their hearts. At times, some had even worshipped, building beautiful statues, never knowing their gods had taken up residence inside. Now, People had long forgotten most of the things they once knew, and his kind had taken to finding their own dwellings. Yet still, when they came to his presence, people found themselves spilling their secrets and never wondered why. The car bounced over a bump in the road and the tiger slumped forward. A paw fell from the seat. His head was in the footwell, his nose resting on an old cheeseburger wrapper nestled in a carpet of cartons and cans. The tiger didn't mind, though. He knew he was exactly where he should be, and he knew exactly where he needed to go. "What the bloody hell is that?" Darrell stared at the tiger, his head cocked at an angle. The tiger was on one side of the dining room table. He reached forward, his hand curling into a fist. "You think that's staying there, Becky? You really have got shape for brains." She turned quickly from the pan of curry.
"No, wait. I'll move him."
"Him?" Darrell's smirk made her stomach clench. "Don't let this be another fight. Not so soon." She purposely kept her voice even.
"I know. It's stupid. You'll laugh. I saw him at the side of the road, and he just looked so forlorn. I thought I could try to dry him out and then clean him and repair him."
"Repair him?" Darrell stepped out of her way and turned to the fridge for his post-work beer. "Jesus, Becky, you've never even picked up a needle."
How did he do that? How did he make the fact that she wasn't a nice little 50s housewife type seem like a failing? At uni, when he was trying to impress everyone, he'd been the first to show off his modern thinking man credentials.
She picked up the tiger and moved him to the floor beside the sofa. There he wouldn't be so obvious.
"Gone, okay?" She gestured to the table. "Now sit down. Food's almost done."
They were silent as she plated the curry up. Darrell swigged his beer and flipped through his phone as if she wasn't there. Only when she put the plate in front of him did he look up. "Thanks," he said, with a smile that didn't reach his eyes. Still, a smile. That was something. Becky waited until he was enjoying his food, then stammered,
He won't get in your way. If you don't think I can repair him, I'll get help."
Darrell raised an eyebrow, fork held in front of his mouth. After a moment, he shook his head once and sighed, "Just do what you want." Later, after he'd gone to bed, she fired up her laptop. He didn't mean to be so unkind. His job was really killing him at the moment. When it was good with him, it was really good, as far as she remembered. Besides, he wasn't wrong about the sewing. But Becky did have skills. She knew how to research, and she knew what she was looking for. "Do you have a favourite soft toy or doll that's seen better days? So surprising, can bring your friend back to their former glory," the website said. There was a before and after picture of Mr. Monkey, who hadn't started in quite such a bad state as Tiger, but still needed a lot of work. There was also a picture of a man, about 30, staring out through retro 1960s glasses, flecks of grey in his 5 o'clock shadow and an open smile. Underneath the photo, it said, "Jack Loomy, proprietor of So Surprising." Becky glanced over her shoulder at the tiger nestled in the dark.
"This could be the guy, Tiger. I think he'll be able to help us."
The tiger shifted as Becky turned back to the screen. Not so far that the girl would notice, just enough so we could watch down the corridor into the bedroom. The lump on the bed shifted and snored. The tiger flexed one soft paw and remembered other bodies. Bodies where he had tooth and nail. Statues where he could hold sword and spear. And this body had nothing sharp, nothing dangerous, nothing to help. The tiger didn't mind, though. He knew he was exactly where he should be, and he knew exactly what he needed to do. Jack Loomy's smile was as friendly as his picture, though his face fell as Becky heaved the tiger up onto the counter. "Oh," he said. "Right."
"Yes, he's been in the wars a bit."
Becky was beginning to feel ridiculous again.
"He isn't mine," she continued,
suddenly feeling the urge to explain she would never treat a tiger in such a way, toy or not.
"Well, he wasn't. I found him by the side of the road. I rescued him."
Jack Loomy looked up at her again, his face split into a grin.
"Don't you dare laugh at me," she thought to herself.
If he did, she'd just go. Take Tiger and go. Instead of laughing, though, he said, "Good for you. Most people wouldn't have bothered. Shame too. Might not be the best workmanship in the world, but he's got personality."
Becky felt her shoulders relax. Oh, great. So, do you think there's hope?
Absolutely, he nodded, turning Tiger around on the bench, examining him all over. I can give him a proper wash, replace his stuffing with something, well, drier and better quality, then sew him up, like an episode of ER.
Becky surprised herself. Joking with a stranger wasn't a common activity.
Old school, he laughed. I miss the ones where they use stuffing, though.
He paused, then glanced at her again.
Didn't fancy trying the repairs yourself.
How did you? Becky didn't consider herself to be a transparent person. The opposite, in fact.
Well, yes. I thought about it, but I don't have the first idea how to.
Don't worry. I'm not a psychic, he said. I ask everyone that comes in. I'm a member of a makers group. We all get together and create things, crafts and such. I always ask in case, well, you know, new members and all that.
My other half already has enough excuses to cast me in the little woman role. Becky continued to surprise herself. I better not give him any more. Oh, no offence.
Jack Loomy waved a hand. None taken at all. Now, can you leave him with me for a few days? The tiger sat tall on the bench. His fur was clean. The oily patch had been deftly removed and replaced by an almost identical piece of fur. His stuffing was new and dry and of a far higher quality than before. The gash in his shoulder was sewn almost shut in an almost imperceptible line. His green eyes were so polished they shone independently of the secret glow beneath. The tiger watched as Jack Loomy pottered around the shop, humming to the radio, slightly out of time and slightly out of tune, contented. The tiger basked in the chats that Jack had when the shop was filled with friendly customers, and in the secrets he told when it wasn't. After a day, Jack moved him to a shelf where he could oversee the whole shop.
Don't worry, mate, Jack said. She'll be back.
As Jack turned away, the tiger's lips opened into a smile. He didn't mind that she hadn't come back yet. She would. And in the meantime, he was exactly where he should be, and he knew exactly where he needed to go.
I'm so sorry, Becky was breathless. It's been work and home and, you know, just life.
Jack said nothing. Instead, he pointed up at a shelf, the corners of his mouth turning up. She followed his finger.
Oh my God!
Her eyes widened. It was Tiger, but he was perfect. He stared down from the shelf, majestic.
How on earth did you manage that? He's incredible.
Huh, thanks. Jack lifted him down onto the counter. I am pretty pleased with him, even if I do say so myself.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Becky stroked a hand down Tiger's back. It was so soft and clean.
I really don't know how you did it.
Well, I'm sure you'll give him a good home now he's ready to live indoors again.
I absolutely will, Becky said, pulling out her purse. Now, what do I owe you?
Call it 40 quid.
Only 40? Are you sure?
I'm sure. You gave me a lot of fun doing it. Jack nodded. Oh, and something else. Becky glanced up. He'd gone a little red in the face. I don't want to bang on about it, but you know that makers club I mentioned? I just thought I'd say it's not all just sewing and macrame, you know, if that's what put you off. We do all sorts. Carpentry, metalwork. We've even got one couple that make robots. He trailed off. Becky held out two £20 notes and nodded, smiling to dispel his discomfort. She knew what embarrassment felt like.
Oh, really? Maybe I'll come along.
He took the proffered notes and replaced them quickly with a flyer. Well, great. There's details of where and when. If you do fancy it, I mean.
And he was so embarrassed. I really felt for him, Becky said, after he'd done such a great job on Tiger.
Daryl was hunched in the passenger seat. Sounds like a prick to me. Becky laughed. Even Daryl's post-work mood wouldn't get to her today. She glanced in the rear-view mirror at Tiger, now sitting proud in the back seat.
Are you jealous, baby?
Yeah, absolutely, he sneered. Course I am. She glanced across.
Well, you do have to admit he's done a lovely job. Perhaps I will go along to this makers group.
I could do with something more than work and watching you being grumpy.
The tiger was given pride of place on the dining table again that night. Darryl suggested it, an edge in his voice that Becky had been too cheerful to notice. The tiger had noticed, though, and welcomed the beginnings of hostility. He watched as Darryl drank can after can of lager, hogging the TV remote, flicking between sports channels. He listened as Darryl's comments and snide remarks slowly ate away at Becky's attempts at conversation, until eventually she clambered from her island at one end of the sofa and said, "I'm going to get an early night." The presence inside the tiger shrank down, hiding the glow as she stroked him. "Coming in with me?" Before she could lift him, Darryl snapped from the sofa. "That thing's not getting in my way in the bedroom. Leave it where it is." Becky sighed and patted the tiger one more time. Her hand felt warm and loving on his fur. "You really do need to start being nicer again, Darryl." Then she turned and left. The tiger watched, calm, patient. He watched as Darryl's frustration fired into fury. He flexed his paws as Darryl downed another lager. He lay still as Darryl loomed over him, whispering, "I'll show her, talking to me like that." He sniffed the air as Darryl moved on to spirits, the scent of whiskey and sweat filling his nostrils. And finally, he felt himself lifted roughly into Darryl's drunken grip. "Right, you strapey tosser," Darryl slurred. "I'll show you what I think of a bloody maker's group." The tiger didn't mind, though. He knew this was exactly where he should be. This was exactly what he'd been waiting for.
"I know just the place for you, tiger," Darryl muttered at the toy in his arms. "Just over there on the railway. Let's see how long you stay clean and dry then. Let's see how long you stay in one piece."
He stumbled down the last apartment step and pushed through the front door with a drunken arm. It was raining again. He grinned viciously to himself. "Lovely night." The apartments were on a dual carriageway, busy during the day, but at this time of night, just a few cars and an occasional lorry heading towards the M40. The railway ran parallel on the far side. Darryl heaved the tiger up higher onto his chest and glanced left. The way was clear. He staggered to the central barrier. The rain was heavy, and he hadn't brought a coat. He clenched his teeth. Life was having another pop at him. The barrier was easy to clamber over, though he almost fell anyway. A thought wandered into his head that perhaps having that last drink hadn't been quite such a good idea. Then he looked at the tiger in his arms. No, it was worth it. It was definitely worth it. He looked right. A lorry 100 yards away, heading towards him. Best to wait on that. The tiger sunk in his grip. Maybe even best to wait on the other side of the barrier. He turned to check. No. Two cars coming that way now. This was the best place. Suddenly, something shifted against his stomach. Darryl jumped. What the hell? He looked down. The tiger was looking back at him. Darryl frowned. There was a strange glow beneath its eyes. No, that couldn't be. It must be the light from the central reservation street lamps. Then the tiger growled. A mouth sewn shut a moment before opened. Perfect white teeth stretched apart. A rich red tongue lolled beneath, vibrating with a deep rumble. The growl turned into a roar. Hot spittle sprayed onto Darryl's face, mixing with the rain. Darryl screamed. He tried to push the tiger off him. Thick material paws clutched around his waist, clamping him to the beast. He tore at the tiger's arms, powerless against the grip. "No, no, 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 no!" Darryl squealed. He stepped backwards off the central reservation. He hardly heard the sound of the air horn blasting to his left, so very close. At the last minute, his head turned. But, by then, it was far too late. Of course, Becky was devastated. Life became a disconnected haze. From the policeman standing dripping at the doorway, through the horrible phone call to his parents, the question of what he'd been doing, the confusion. Then the returning of his possessions, his wallet, his shoes, the all but ruined cuddly tiger. Still dazed by it all, she stuffed the tiger into a black plastic bag and shut him in a cupboard, half hearing the funeral celebrant and Darryl's mother discussing arrangements in dull, matter-of-fact voices. She slogged through the next weeks,
treating each moment like a maze that she had to find a way through before moving on to the next. She listened as people she loved told her the things they'd been conditioned to say in the face of mortality. She observed as the people that she just knew tried to avoid her gaze and her company. As the weeks turned to months, something began to occur to her. She wasn't devastated anymore. She wasn't even sad. And now, she coasted through her days, neither dreading nor looking forward to anything. It was Maeve at work that asked one day, "Have you cleared his things out?" It just hadn't occurred to Becky. It had been their apartment. But now, why not? She resolved to start as soon as she got home. She found the flyer in his jacket as she stuffed it into the fourth green recycle bag of clothes. She hadn't checked any other pockets, so why she suddenly wanted to check this was beyond her. The flyer was crumpled, but she knew what it was. Oxford Makers. Come and see what you can do. She stood staring at it for a long time, breathing softly. The sound of traffic buzzed distant and steady in the background. She lifted her head, glanced into the cupboard. There, on the other side, long ignored, was the black plastic bin liner, and at the top where the opening was, dirty white fur poked out. Mostly, the tiger sits on a soft bed now. From where he sits, he can see out of the window of Becky's new bedroom. He watches out through the garden past her workshop where, these days, she makes furniture for delighted customers. He watches out to the fields beyond. He's content. The tiger's popular. When her friends from the Makers group come over, they always want to see him. They tell themselves that it's because of the incredible second repair job that Becky and Jack had done together. They tell themselves it's because they want to look at the fabulous stitching. But then they stay, and some of them find themselves talking as if it's the most natural thing in the world. And Becky hears them, and smiles, and understands. And occasionally, when Jack comes home from So Surprising, the tiger finds himself gently moved onto the sofa in the lounge, facing away from the bedroom door. The tiger doesn't mind, though. He listens, smiling as the bedroom door shuts, and the giggling is replaced by other sounds. He knows he's exactly where he should be, and he knows, for these lives at least, he doesn't have anywhere else he needs to go.